Hi guys, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. Thanks for popping in with us today, glad to have you here. Today I've got something a little bit new for you, may not have heard of it, not much information out there about it, but I think it's a pretty useful tool to help integrate with our existing setups, including our hard link videos and our media server videos. So if you haven't watched our hard link videos, I always recommend you check that out. It's really useful, it really helps with the impact on your system when it comes to all the media automation tools, including Plex. So today this video will work hand in hand with that. And we're going to be looking at Autoscan. So what is Autoscan? So as it says here, Autoscan replaces the default Plex and Emby behavior for picking up file changes on the file system. It integrates with Sonarr, Radarr, Lidarr, and Google Drive to fetch changes in near real time without relying on the file system. And if you're a user of Plex, you're probably aware that sometimes it can get quite annoying when you make changes on the file system and then a massive scan gets triggered, basically putting heaps of load onto your server and onto your systems there. So the beauty of this application is it will actually queue the scans and it will check for changes in real time and apply the scan to that folder only, so that Plex doesn't have to go looking through an entire library and triggering a massive scan, which is unnecessary. So before I start, I would like to take a quick second here just to thank all the people that support us financially over on the IBRACORP website, IBRACORP.io, as well as all of my moderators and community members in the Discord who have been helping immensely with other users' questions and giving suggestions. And today, a specific shout out to our member Hawks, who has provided heaps of input to the community. Him and Disc Duck, both of them have been really great in helping our members get more information out there and answer their questions that I may not be able to answer all the time. So today Hawks actually wrote up a lot of the instructions for this video, and so we're going to be walking through and using some of his templates. If this sounds interesting and you want to cut down the load on your server and improve the performance with your scans, this is the video for you. So let's get into it. Alright guys, so we're here on the GitHub page for the developer who's created this. We'll scroll up, of course, we got to give credit to Cloudbox. Cloudbox is the developer on the GitHub, Cloudbox/Autoscan is their repository. And they've done a lot of work with this, which is really fantastic. I did see that there was a previous version, as you can see, there was one called Plex Autoscan. Autoscan is a rewrite of the original Plex Autoscan written in the Go language. In addition, this rewrite introduces a more modular approach and should be easy to extend in the future. So we're going to be going with this version today, and it's obviously been recently updated, whereas the other one I don't think it has, last I checked. But I'm going to simplify it for you so that we can have a better understanding of how this all works together. So the first thing we'll do is jump into your Unraid server, and today we're going to be using our live environment Zeus, and the reason why is because this is a more established server, it's going to make a lot more sense using these sort of tools, because it's already assuming that you've set up the basics of having a Plex server, Sonarr, Radarr, etc. So first thing you want to do, head over to the App Store. In the App Store, we're going to look up Autoscan. Here we've got Hot.io's repository, great developer, I've already mentioned him a few times for his work on different applications, so he currently is the only one on here with this anyway, so a big thank you to him for his work on this. Once you've got this up, pretty much just go ahead and click to install and go to default. Now it's a pretty basic template, there's nothing too much that we have to change, but I am going to add a couple of things here. So the first thing we'll do, expand everything just to make sure we can see it all. You see you've got the slash config. Now if you're using the default app data location, that works fine, you can just leave it as that. The Plex login, obviously use your login for Plex, so I'll go ahead and put mine in at the end. Under the network type, I'll set it to our custom network type. We're also going to add two fields, so we're going to go ahead under here and click on add. In the container path, we're going to put data, and under the host path, we're going to put the user/data/media. Now, this is us using our hard linking video to understand how our mappings are working. So basically, we've got everything living under this data/media folder, okay? And that allows our hard links to work and function correctly. So again, if you haven't seen that video, please check that one out on our channel because it will make a lot more sense to have everything unified. And this is our preferred method here at IBRACORP. Other channels might do it differently, but I can guarantee you that once you go to this method, you won't really go back. So once we've got that there, we can just go ahead and click add. The other thing we're gonna add is a port. So under here, under add again, we're just gonna go port. You can just call that port. And the default port that these operate on will be 3030. So we'll put 3030 twice in there. So we've got the port 3030, 3030 again. Go ahead and click add, and there you go. So now I'll put in my Plex details, and you'll do the same. So put your email address and your password here for Plex. And then once you're done, just go ahead and click apply. So we've clicked apply, now we're just gonna wait for it to install. Now we'll click done. So open up your file browser and we'll head down to the app data location where the configuration should have been created. So we're in our network share for Zeus and we can see the app data folder and the Autoscan folder that's been created. So open that up and you'll notice here it's got a Plex token and some other Autoscan and configuration information. So that token didn't exist previously and the reason why it's been created is because we put our username and password in the template for Plex. So then it's gone and created this for us and pulled the token down. So what you'll need to do is open up this config.yml. Now there's two ways I recommend you can do this. One is using something like Notepad++. The other is using Visual Studio. And the reason why is because those two apps will help you see it in the correct format. If you have an incorrect spacing or anything like that, it basically breaks these files. So guys, I recommend using a specialist tool for that, not just Notepad. So once you've got that, we can right click it and go either open or edit with Notepad++. I'm gonna go with +++ today. And here's our configuration file. So all of our work is gonna be done in this file today. So what I'll do is just based on some feedback you guys have given me, I'm just gonna zoom up a little bit. For those watching on mobile, hopefully this makes it a bit easier for you to see. So this is pretty much empty. There's nothing in here, so there's nothing actually working and that's perfectly fine. So what we're gonna do is start filling it out. Now, lucky for you guys, I have a template here already written up working with Hawks, and thanks to his suggestions here, it's gonna make it a lot easier to get this going. So it's not gonna make a lot of sense, but what we'll do is we'll just copy everything in here pretty much and I'll walk you through it. And we'll start right at the top. So minimum age. Autoscan does not check whether scan requests received by triggers exist on the file system. Therefore, to make sure a file exists before it reaches the target, we need to set a minimum age. The minimum age delays the scan from being sent to the targets after it has been added to the queue by a trigger. The default minimum age is set at 10 minutes to prevent common synchronization issues. So here I've got at 2 minutes 30 seconds. You can set that pretty much at whatever you like. You know, in my case today I'll set it at 5 minutes. So to do that we have to put a 5 followed by M for minutes. There you go. Scan delay, pretty self-explanatory. If we want to delay the scan by how long, we can set that timer here as well. So we've got that set to 15 seconds. Scan stats, and that's basically if you're looking at the logs, it will actually print out a statistics or what's happening with the scans at a certain interval. So at the moment it's set to every 30 minutes and every 30 minutes it will say how many scans are waiting and how many are queued and things like that. So that's just a little bit of housekeeping stuff. That's up to you what your personal preference is. I find these values work okay as well. Authentication, so this will come in later when we connect it to Sonarr and Radarr, and that basically allows you to have an authentication on the URL request. You're gonna make that a lot more secure. Then we have anchors. So I'll explain to you anchors really quickly here. So to prevent the processor from calling targets when a remote mount is offline, we can define a list of so-called anchor files. These anchor files do not have any special properties and often have no content. However, they can be used to check whether a file exists on the file system. If the file does not exist and you have not made any changes to the file, then it is certain that the remote mount must be offline or the software is having problems. So when an anchor file is unavailable, the processor will halt its operations until the file is back online. So it just gives it a way to check that that location is available and online before it tries to make any changes. So we're gonna head back to Zeus to be able to create these anchor files. And this is gonna be the quickest way to do it here in Unraid. So we've got this command here, make directory, going to the user data media, makes this file and creates it in that location. It's worth noting again that this is assuming you have set up your setup like our hard linking video. So these file locations, this directory is matching that video setup. If you have a different one for your media, maybe it's called user/automation/media, then you need to update this. But this is ours, so we're just gonna go ahead and copy that. Head back to your server, and in the top right, we can open up a terminal window. Pop the terminal window, right click and paste. So now we've got that directory there, looks good. Go ahead and click enter. That's pretty much it. So if I was to open up the file explorer, and we try to go to that location, which is user/data, that's our share there, media, and there's our anchor. So that's our anchor location there set up and ready to go. So if we go back to our configuration file, it's referencing the right location now. So we're happy with that, we can move on to the next step. The port is 3030 and we already preemptively set that up when we created the template, so that's perfectly fine too. Obviously if 3030 is not available for you, make sure you update it. So then comes the triggers. So triggers are pretty much the input that Autoscan gets. They translate incoming data into a common data format called the scan. And Autoscan supports two kinds of triggers. They support daemon processes, which are triggers run in the background and fetch resources based on a cron schedule. Then there's webhooks. These triggers expose HTTP handlers, which can be added to the trigger's software. So in our case, that's obviously Sonarr and Radarr. And we're going to go with the webhook option. That's our root directory for our media, so we want it to look there for any changes. Under the paths, we've got /media/movies and /media/TV. So obviously for Radarr, that's where our location is, and that's where it is for Sonarr. So we want to make sure that that's correct. So in here, we're saying include that here for the scan, and here's the paths that we want you to keep an eye on. For the targets, then we have Plex, but this doesn't just work for Plex. So we've got Plex, Emby, Jellyfin. They're the three that they've got listed. And so you would configure these similar with a couple of differences. If you are using anything except for Plex, which is what we're covering today, if you want to use it for Jellyfin or Emby, then I'll recommend looking at the Autoscan GitHub page just to make sure you get all the right variables. But this is assuming you're going to do it for Plex. So we're nearly there pretty much, and it's nearly set up. So basically URL, obviously the URL of your Plex instance. Now this can be both your internal address or the external address if you want it to go out and come back through the reverse proxy. So then there's the last thing we need to put into this file, which is the Plex token. Pretty straightforward to get that. The first thing we need to do is head to Plex. So once you're in Plex, open up a piece of media in your library, go to More and go to Get Info. Under here, you'll see View XML. Go ahead and click that. And in the top URL bar, if we go all the way to the right, you'll see a code here called Plex Token. Copy the Plex Token from the URL bar and bring it back here into your config file. Once you've done that, you can go ahead and click Save. And just scrolling through the file one last time, we can see that everything looks pretty good. The next part we have to do now is connect it to Sonarr and Radarr and then make one setting change in Plex. So now we're in Sonarr, go ahead and go to Settings. Under Settings, go to Connect. Hit the plus icon, select webhook. In the webhook name, we'll just give it a name that obviously works for you. So I'm just gonna use Autoscan. So we only want import and upgrade. We'll untick the other two, and we'll also tick on series delete and episode file delete as well. As well as this one here, which is delete for upgrade. So as you can see in this case, because I have Autoscan on the same custom Docker network, I can just refer to it by Autoscan. I don't need to have the full IP address. We've then got the port number, which we configured. So then there's this other part that we need to add as well. So we /triggers/ the name of the trigger. Now, if you're not sure what that is, if we go back to the configuration file real quick, the name is this part here that's being referenced. And this is so that we don't have duplicates of the same trigger. So if you were to rename this to something else, then that would be the one you use at the end of that URL. So in this case, we've called it Sonarr. And if we go back to Sonarr, we need to make sure we've got /triggers/Sonarr. The method is post, and the username and password is obviously what we've configured in the top of the file here. That way we can authenticate all the transactions that are happening through. Go ahead and click test. I just had another look there on the documentation, and we can actually support rename as well. So we'll go ahead and click rename, and then for the Sonarr, we'll go series delete, episode delete. We'll untick this one. So basically you've got on import, on upgrade, rename, series delete, and episode file delete. Once you've done that, we can test it one last time, go ahead and click save. You might be wondering whether that's actually worked. So if we open that up and we click test, go back to your Docker, check the logs for Autoscan. And as you can see in the logs for Autoscan, we can see the test event come through. So that's good. That means it's communicating fine. Obviously Sonarr will tell you if it can't communicate as well. So we're happy with that. We can just leave it as is. Pretty much now repeat the same steps and do the same thing with Radarr. So I'll go ahead and do that and cut to it for you. Now guys, if you get in this situation, I will just add that I missed a important step. So we made the changes on our configuration file, as you can see here, but we haven't restarted the container so that it picks up these new changes. So we'll need to go back to the Docker list and we'll just restart the container here. That way you can pull all the settings that we've just set up and then you should be able to test things again and it will work. So once we've done that, we can click save, and now we've pretty much set up Sonarr and Radarr. That part is now complete. So there's one more step that we'll need to do, and that's in Plex. So Autoscan replaces Plex's default behavior of updating the Plex library automatically. Therefore, it is advised to turn off Plex's update my library automatically feature. So if we go into your settings for Plex and head over down to library here, And what we'll do is uncheck scan my library automatically. So that way we don't want it to do the scans for us. Now, to be honest with you guys, I'm not sure whether the second option of run a partial scan when changes are detected is necessary or not. Now, because it's supposed to be replacing this automatic scan feature, I'm thinking that we probably don't need that. The instructions for the auto scan application don't explicitly say anything about this. So I'm going to untick it because it kind of, to me, sounds like it probably shouldn't be running. And on top of that, the scan periodically also could be an issue too. So we're going to uncheck that one as well. And we'll go ahead and click save. In theory, the idea is that now that we've done that, it should only scan one location and still trigger a scan in Plex. So what we'll have to do is actually request something and see whether it works. So we'll go over here and we'll just add something real quick. So we've just added some content and we're going to wait for that to process. So we'll keep the logs open and we'll just keep an eye on it and we'll see what happens once this is finished processing. And this way we can see all three areas. So we can see if Plex starts doing anything, whether Radarr starts doing anything, and whether Autoscan does its thing as well. Okay, our file is just about done. So we're about to see what happens now once this is finished. The imports happened. There we go. We've just seen the trigger and Autoscan run. Scan has been moved. Trigger has been executed. So it's gone to the folder. So that's good. That means that the communication between Radarr and Autoscan is good. It's picked it up on the actual file server. Okay, we can start seeing our first issue now, which is that it's telling us the anchor file is unavailable. So just looking back in our file here. Okay, that is a mistake on my behalf. In the code that we used here, as you can see, so we've got it as .anchor rather than anchors, which is what's written here. So that is my mistake, my apologies. So if we save that, and we'll go ahead and restart the container, that should then find the correct location. All right, guys, so I found the issue on why it's not finding the anchor file. And if we go back to basics here, we're looking at the template. We can see that I've mapped the data to the data/media folder. So what we've done is we've said that the host path media is referred to as data. Now that's not actually correct. So what we want to do is actually remap that, and we'll take the media part out so that it's mapping to the data on the top level as well. So go ahead and click apply, and then it should find our anchor file this time. And there we go. That was the issue. So that was my mistake, guys. And now that we've had a chance to actually look at it in practice, I might even drop that down back to the 2 minutes and 30 seconds marker, because it did take quite a while to kick in, which we probably don't need. And I'll set the scan stats to probably 15 minutes, just so we can be aware of what's happening a little bit more regularly as well. Always remember, any changes you make to a configuration file, you restart the container so it picks up those new changes. Also, if you're not aware, be sure to set the container to auto start and use this arrow on the right hand corner here to move it into the startup order you would like it to be. So something like Autoscan, I probably want it to kick off prior to Plex, which is all the way down here, so I can move that. So I can move that to probably around where Jacket is and be happy with that. Now, if you wanted it to have a delay, remember to click advanced view and you can set in seconds how long you want it to wait. Plenty of other Docker tips in our Docker tips and tricks video as well. But that is pretty much how to help control your Plex scanning capabilities with Autoscan. I hope that was helpful, guys. Be sure to tune in with us soon. Please remember to like and subscribe. It really helps the channel out. I really appreciate you guys. Another big thanks to everyone who supports us on our website, whether it's just by membership or financially. Anything you do to help is always appreciated. So thank you very much. Be sure to join our Discord if you're interested, where you can post your requests and help out other members of the community. Glad to have you on board, and we'll see you in the next IBRACORP video.